haven't they issued a single subpoena? The FCIC, which is supposed to be writing the definitive history of this, hasn't issued a subpoena. We want to know what's going on. I wrote an op-ed back in December, so it's a couple months ago, saying we own AIG. We as taxpayers, we deserve to know what happened as among AIG, Treasury, the Fed. We own the company. Why don't they release the entire year their email stream so we can actually parse the relationship and then radiate out from there and understand these transactions? What was going on? Nobody in Washington has been willing to pick up that mantle and say, yes, there's a decent idea. They haven't even issued the subpoenas that would let us understand what was going on between Goldman and AIG about $12.9 billion. Even after there was a very good IG report that said this thing is fraught with serious issues. Issue some subpoenas, and if they don't have the guts to do that, then we know that this is just a canard. Last point about where we are on the regulatory side. The issue of a consumer agency. It would be wonderful to have. It would be great to have the consumer protection function centralized, localized, in an independent, self-sustaining entity with Elizabeth Warren at the top. That would be great. Better to have her on the Supreme Court, but fine to have her doing consumer protection. Here's the problem. The banks, I believe, are intentionally turning this into this litmus test of success or failure in terms of all of regulatory reform so that they will concede that issue some way, shape, or form at the end, meanwhile distracting everybody from the larger structural issues that reform should really be focusing on. This is one of the greatest bait-and-switch operations we've ever seen. They don't care if there's a separate consumer protection agency that much. But they do care if suddenly too big to fail is targeted in a meaningful way. They do care if suddenly there's an OCC with somebody at the top who's going to enforce the law the right way. What they are doing is creating an alternative issue for us to care about so that we will win back. They will shed crocodile tears all the way to the bank as they say, gee, we won this regulatory fight one more time. All right, let me pivot to what I said was the third question. Are we creating jobs? And here is why we simply cannot calculate the cost of what we've gone through in the last 2 years. We have lost minimum 8 million jobs. Those jobs have been lost into the ether and will be almost impossible to recreate right now. The anemic job growth we saw last month, a third of it was from temporary hires for the census. We've all seen these numbers. We are close to an 18-19% real unemployment rate. Things are grim. And what I ask you to think about when I say they're grim, compare where the United States is today, and I'm not saying this because I'm a pessimist, I'm not, I'm an optimist, but to understand the reality of where we are, compare where the United States is today versus 1945. 1945, we were the only nation with capital in its traditional sense of money, the only nation with the rule of law, the only nation with skilled labor, the only nation with a middle class market that could provide a base for consumer products to be produced and sold easily. We were the only nation with the innovative skill to generate the products that would then be sold. On virtually every one of those metrics, we are now behind other nations. And that is what makes it so much harder today to climb out of the swamp we've thrown ourselves into because we have lost so much ground. It is not just in January of this year that there were more cars sold in China than in the United States. This past month, General Motors sold more cars in China than in the United States. So if you want to see where the epicenter of economic growth and dynamism is, that's what we're facing. And that is why the structural problems that we are facing are so significant. And those structural problems have been exacerbated by the banking crisis and the failure of our financial services sector to do what it is most fundamentally designed to do, which is to aggregate capital, allocate that capital wisely to companies here that will invest in a good way. What they've done instead is turn themselves into proprietary hedge funds, which may or may not make money off the back of taxpayers, but certainly have not provided the steady flow of capital into our economy that we need. So unfortunately, my view is we're failing. We've got a lot of ground to make up, and hopefully we can do so. Thank you so much.